Let's go for it here. So 3.5 homework to go. Number 36, what we start off with. Oh, sorry, 37. We have one, two, three, four different graphs here. And again, if I have the homework page, which I don't, so I can't show it to you, but you guys should look in your textbook here. So it matches you the following statements to the appropriate graph indicating tables 1 through 4. Again, real quick here, quick class, if you guys can keep it down so I can actually talk, people in the back hear me. Learn sign language again if you need to. Cool. Okay. So Sarah works 25 hours to earn $250. Justin works 35 hours to earn $560. Huh. And then it talks about hours worked and dollars earned. I guess we can do it one of two ways here. First, let me just sort of draw this here. So number one is the highest graph. Number two, second highest graph. Number three comes in third place. I'm going to stretch it out just a little bit here just so you can see the difference here. A little closer together in the graph here. We can do one of two ways here. You can either see if this particular points are on the graph here. So I'm going to say Sarah worked 25 hours. If you look across here on the bottom, 25 hours, there's 20. 25 is about right here. And earned $250 so that you can go up the scale and see where $250 is. And if you do that, you find out, whoa, look at that. It's that point right there. Good there. There's A. So you can do it by individual dots. Good there, maybe. And pretty much that's probably why, how the book wants you to do it here. It's testing whether you can get that point there on the graph. So for A, the answer would be number 3. So then we go, Justin works 35 hours, earns $560. And again, I should have made this a little like this more so. Everything ends at 40. So 35 is about right here. If you look at 35, you scroll up to $560, that's number 1. It's all the way up here. Good there. And again, have to be looking at your textbook to make sense of this here. But that's going to be number 1. That's the highest paid. Justin has a pretty good job. C, Rosemary works 30 hours to earn $360. Again, 30 hours, 360. So at 30 hours, you're going to be a little bit above $300, in between $300 and $400. And that looks like C right here. So that's number 2. And the fun one, D. Of course, if that's the last one left, there's only 4 of them. That have to be it. Marcus earns 40 hours to earn $320. 40 hours. 320 should be a little bit above $300. And right at the end, that's number 4. There's D. Okay, good there. Hopefully makes sense now. A little bit more than it was before. Okay, 36. Sorry, 3.6, number 27. Again, we have to do this here real quick here. F has quite a bit of points here, then G has quite a bit of points. And for 27, it actually says find G of 1/2. So I'm going to sort of emphasize G right here. The points for G is a set called 1, 1, negative 2, 2, and 1/2, 0. Again, this is called the alternative definition for functions. Functions is defined just to be points from here that go to here. So, or set of ordered pairs. Start here, you go to here. Start here, you go to here. So if you say g of 1/2, which means g means you're going to use this function as opposed to the f function. The input or the x coordinate has to be the 1/2. And then over here has to be the y coordinate, whatever is the output. In this case, you just go like this. You say, aha. 1/2 actually corresponds to a y value of 0. And the answer is 0.
What do you mean? 1/2 or 1?
No, because this does not give you a formula. it gives you a mapping, which I can illustrate a different way like this. 1 goes to 1, negative 2 goes to 2, and 1 half goes to 0. That's what your function is all about. And so if you say, what's g of 1 half? Well, there's my domain. I find 1 half on my domain. I say, what is it in the range? It is 0 in the range. So let's go for it. If you say what's g of 1 is 1, g of negative 2, positive 2. There's only 3 points in this domain. There's no others, and there's a correspondence to each one. All right, we go good? 27, good. 55, then 57, 58. 55. All right, antidepressant sales, something we start off, I think we had a practice problem on that. Those X mean the year. Suppose that we have three functions, F, G, and H, do the following. F pairs each with a total of Zoloft. G pairs it with Effexor. And H pairs it with sales in billions of dollars a year. That's humongous. Okay. So we're going to answer a few questions that have to do with functions. If you can answer it, again, you're getting this sort of vocabulary, how we deal with functions. That's kind of what you want. So the domain for G is true or false? So the domain for G is 2003, 2004, 2005. So if we look at a little graph, the x-coordinate represents the one of the years in the chart. So yeah. There's only 3 years worth of data we have, right? So the domain is just going to be these numbers right here. So that is a true statement. It just means we have, what we're looking at is just three different year values. The domain for G is, and this one's a little different, the set of all X such that, and again, this one's trying to show you a difference here. All right, this one would be false, and the reason for it is because years are not, we call it continuous functions. Like time. Time is more like a continuous function, right? You can get it down to 2.57862 seconds, right? It's a continuum. Where the data is represented here, it doesn't connect one to the other to the other. It says year this, this happened. So we call A something called discrete. Good vocabulary term. This is called a discrete function because it gives you individual years and data for those particular years. Yeah, but it's saying it's a continuous function, which means it's, you could be sliced up into months, then years and days and minutes and seconds, and it's not in it. You're just given individual year and totals for that year. C, let's see if this is case. F of 2004 is greater than G of 2004. And again, very good graph. Very good questions here. Really test your knowledge of whether you know functions in an abstract manner. So let's go with it. F pairs Zoloft and Effexor. So at 2004 on the graph, for 2004, let's go with Zoloft sales were this much, Effexor sales were this much. So the question is F of 2004 bigger? Is the value, of, and let's see, if we're talking about values themselves. For 2004, the sales for Zoloft is about $3.0 billion. For Eff- specs are, it's about 2.6 or something, 2.5, whatever. But see how that's bigger? You're comparing the Y coordinates as opposed to the X coordinates. And again, the graph itself is sort of trying to trick you because it's sideways. The bar graph's going sideways. So it's really testing whether you really know the concepts as opposed to seeing the scales here. Okay, D. H of 2005, is that greater than 1.5? So let's go over here on the scale for 2005. Now this is H, this is the last graph. So looking at that, 2005, it's the red graph that we're looking at. And notice it is actually exactly 1.5, right? It's right on that decimal point. So if we look at this, this would be 1.5, this would be 1.5. So true or false? I can't tell. What I could tell is I could just say it's 1.5 exactly, because it's right on the decimal point, so this would be false, because this is saying that the value is supposed to be greater than 1.5, and it isn't. It's exactly 1.5. Changing the problem just slightly. Let me change the problem. If it said this, if it said H of 2005 is greater than or equal to 1.5, what do I say here? Yeah, it's true, because it's exactly 1.5. So if it was like this, then it'd be a true statement, but it's a false statement. Okay, and E. Let's see if this works here. H of 2005 is greater than H of 2004, which means it was increasing in sales, which is H 2003. So the year 2005 for H was bigger than or greater than the So let's take a look at the Y values. For 2005, H, Wellbutrin, there you go, that is a U as opposed to it. Thanks, nurse. Okay, this is a 1.5 here. For 2004, looking at the chart, it's approximately 1.0. And for 2003, whoa, barely came on the market, looks like. It's maybe like 0.2 or something like that. So is that true?
Yeah.
Yeah. So ever since year 2003, it's been increasing steadily to a certain point. So this is true. Again, really good questions to really test your knowledge of how you're looking at graphs correctly, or you're looking at functions correctly. Okay. Keep on going here. 3.6, number 56. This is the function V of t. Again, big numbers here, 3,300t plus 18,000, where V is the value and t is the time. Can be used to find the value of a large copy machine during the first 5 years of use. Did we do this problem or no? I feel like we did this problem. Numbers. Okay. What's the value of the copy after 3 years, 9 months? So then we got to think about 3 years, because this is in terms of years only, right? 3 years, 9 months. How much does that translate in terms of just years? Well, let's see, that would be 3 years. Yeah, 3 years and 9 over 12, right? Because it's 9 months out of 12. And that would actually reduce down to 9 goes in, that's 3, huh? 3 goes in 9 three times? 3 goes into 12 four times. Is that 3 3/4 of a year? So converting that into improper fraction, that's going to be 12, 13, 14, 15. So that's 15/4. We good there? Technically, it's sort of 15/4 of a year. Okay, so what we're really trying to figure out is this. What's the value at 15/4 of a year? So again, 3 years and 9 months. So plugging that in, that's 15 divided by 4, and then of course you may want to probably use a little calculator maybe to finish it off. And anybody help me out here. So negative 3,300 times 15, all that divided by 4, plus 18,000. So about 5,000, yeah. Negative 3300. Ah, how fun. It's a program that I put together. Four different programs on the internet. And as soon as I did that, TI came over. It's something called an emulator. So go to TI and just type in TI emulator. And if you have a smartphone, I don't know about, yeah, both. I haven't seen an Apple, sorry, iPhone has it as well. There's emulators as well as Android phones. They have that. It's kind of cool. It's an app, except the only thing is you have to own the ROM from the computer itself, from the calculator itself. You have to somehow get the ROM from it. Okay, so 5,625. Are we good? Maybe sometimes. Calculus that we're good. Alright, I have a sneaky feeling we're not going to get through 4-3 today. Okay, what's the salvage value of a copy if it's replaced after 5 years? So again, real quick here, punch into 5, see what you guys get. So negative 3,300 plus 18,000, what do you get there? Okay, where is this sort of stuff used at? I've seen it used before in when you give value for tax purposes. Because you can never, it's much easier to get a value over, again, like assets. This would be an asset because it's a copy machine of an office. So what you do is you give asset value. And instead of trying to figure out what's the value in the marketplace for that particular month and that particular time, what would you say, look, after 5 years, usually copiers are worthless. So I'm going to do a linear asset depreciation for taxes. And so then you list it, and that's usually okay with the IRS. Long as it's done fairly. So state the domain of the function. Well, in the problem itself, it says it was a value where V is a value of T for the first 5 years of its use. So it already actually gave it to you. And so it said, set of all x, such that from 0, you go all the way up to 5. Or given an online homework way, it'd be like this, 0 to 5. That'd be more of the way it wants it online, most likely. It says, sketch the graph of the function. And again, we don't need to do quadrant 2, 3, or 4, just need to do quadrant 1. And so, again, you want to get individual points. We already have some. 3 years, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. At year 5, it's worth that much. And the highest value it's worth is 18,000. So I'll probably go maybe every 5,000. I'm going to go up to 20,000. So 5,000, 10,000, 15,000, 20,000. And this is year 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we know that in 3 years and 9 months, we know it has a value of 5,000. About right there, is that right? Put that at 600. We know that by year 5, it's worth 1,500, which is just barely above zero. And so, if you put in a t's equals zero in here, you know that's going to be 18,000 right away. That's kind of cool. So again, from these dots, we have 3 points. But we only need really 2 points to determine a straight line. So it's a closed dot here, because at year zero, we take the value. And it goes down to year 5, and there's a closed dot right there. Again, not hitting zero, it's just a little bit above zero. And again, for tax purposes, you're saying year 6, I'm not even going to claim it as an asset anymore. Alright, what's the range? Now we can finally answer the range question, because you really need to look at the graph. Okay, so this is D. The range is from 18,000, again, bracket. 18,000 down to 1,500. The only thing is, remember, with range, we start low and we go higher, right? We have to go this way for range. So the range that I see is right here. This is the Y values that work for that. So the way the book wants it is a set of all Y such that 1,500 is less than or equal to Y less than or equal to 18,000. And if you did it the online version, it would be bracket 1,500 to 18,000. After how many years will the copy worth machine only $10,000? So F. When is it going to be worth only $10,000? Well, now we have ourselves an algebra problem, because we're saying this. $10,000 is the value. It's V of T. So again, the $10,000 comes in for the V value, and we got ourselves an algebra to solve problem. So subtract 18,000 from 10,000, makes negative 8,000, negative 3300T, divide through by negative 3300, and anybody with that number. Simple division. Knock off zeros for you. How about that? Knock off that one and that one. So how about 80 divided by 33? I go with that. 2.42 years. And again, if you really want to convert to months, go for it, but I can just leave it there. That's fine. Cool. All right. 58 off of 3.6. All right, this one, even problem. And again, did we do this already? Yes, no? Didn't I do this already? Okay, I'm getting two classes confused, that's why. Okay, so this one, I did want to show you this here, because this is called a step function. Those of you that are going to go on into pre-calculus or going into the science field, you at least need to see this guy. And I put in a certain value here. So this is envelopes. And this is how much, I'm going to get, keeps on going. and it tells you what this is. There's 39 cents, 63 cents, 87 cents, and so on. Again, a different type of function called the step function. And what this means is this. Instead of having just one nice curve that goes up or go down, it goes in steps. So it sort of jumps. I think we have something like that. Whenever you guys use a cell phone or any kind of phone, they're always billed in 1 minute increments, is that right? So if you were on the phone for exactly 1 minute, how much do you get charged for? 1 minute, right? If you're on the phone for exactly 1 minute and 2 seconds, how much do you get charged for? 2 minutes. So same thing here. It goes to here. So sending a package in the U.S. mail is 39 cents, no matter what the first ounce or portion of the first ounce is. So if it's exactly 1 ounce, you're going to pay 39 cents. If it's 1.1 ounces, then you're going to have to jump to 63 cents. And that's kind of, again, just for you guys to see a step function. And so I'll put W is weight, and cost is over here. So how much would you give for 0.6 of an ounce? 39 cents, because it doesn't matter. The first ounce is that. How about if exactly 1.0 ounces? 39 cents. What about if it was exactly 1.1 ounces? A little bit over? 63. 2.5 ounces? I guess a 2.5 goes here. 87 cents. 3.0 ounces? Still 87 cents, right? And let me make more boxes here. 5 ounces. 1.35 cents, or 135 cents, if you look at the graph itself, and then 5.3. Alright, 159. We're good there. Alright, B says, if a letter costs 87 cents to mail, how much does it weigh? So if it costs 87 cents, it's right here, huh? Perfect, but is it exactly 2.0? It's a little above. Yeah, so you would say it weighs, again, parentheses, 2.0 up to 3.0 bracket. Does that make sense? Not including 2.0, anything above 2.0, but exactly. Kind of. All right, another way to write it is 2.0 less than x, less than or equal to 3.0. So notice one of them is less than, one of them are less than or greater. Again, if you get that distinction, doing good. That's exactly what you should be thinking. If the entire function is shown in figure 3, state the domain. What is the domain of this guy? Well, if you think about it, can I plug in any value from 0 all the way to, looks like 6? Yeah. 2.4, 2.42, 2.0003, all those I can plug in. So domain is from 0. Now real quick here, are we including 0 or no? Not including 0, because it doesn't make sense to mail nothing. Right, so it's going to be less than, let me do it this way, 6.0 bracket 4, again, same thing, 0 less than x less than or equal to 6.0. And again, we don't know what happens after 6.0. Does it go into a priority package, which is a totally different thing now? Do they not accept letters, first class postage over 6 ounces? I'm not sure. Okay, D, state the range of the function. What is the range of the function? Perfect. But hold on. Let me ask you a question. Is it continuous or is it individual numbers? They're individual numbers. It's exactly 39 cents. Then it hops to exactly 63 cents. Then it's exactly 87 cents. So this is where that mapping sort of becomes very important. So you'd say the range is the individual numbers, 39 cents, 63 cents, 87 cents, 111 cents, 135 cents, and 159 cents. Good, it's those individual pieces. Okay, I think that was good. Again, if you're getting this stuff, 3.6, 3.5, very abstract, weird stuff. But if you're understanding the questions, you're understanding the verbiage and vocabulary of functions. How to see functions. Okay, that was 3.6, and we're 40 minutes into class. Okay, let's do these quickly, four, and then we'll go on. Out of the abstract section, let's get into numbers finally. 17 and 24, so 3.7. Okay, it says, for the following problems, f varies directly with m and inversely the square of d. Ooh. Okay, we got to write the abstract formula first. Force is equal to directly with m. Don't forget your k value, k. That's your proportional constant, but it's directly with m, inversely with the square of d. Where is this coming from? This is a physics problem. It talks about how much force objects have on themselves. And according to Newton, that had this, every single object in this room has actually force that is pulling you towards that object. Isn't that kind of weird? Think about it. So, again, individual people, the desk around you, the ceiling, the floor, everything is sort of pulling you towards itself. And it says that the one with the most amount of pressure is going to win. In our sense, gravity right now is helping us sit in that chair. Right? It's forcing us to that chair. And that's the force that's overwhelming all the other forces. That's kind of weird, sort of sense to that. Okay, anyways, let's go for it. 17. It says that force is 150. Again, we're trying to figure out what's my proportional constant here. M is 240. And D is 8. So 8, again, don't forget it's squared. So I've got to figure this out first. Alright, 240. And that will do 64. Does 240 go into 6, or does 64 go into 240? Out of curiosity. If not, we can just simplify it. 3.75. If you want to do work with decimals, again, if you have a handy calculator, go for it. I got 3.75 again. D dividing that. And is it exactly 3.75? Okay, cool. And again, if it was something else not exact, I wouldn't use it. But this is exact. So that means I'm going to divide this guy by this guy. And what's my K value? What's my proportional constant here? So 150 divided by 3.75. Okay, so again, particular for this problem, there it is. It's 40 m over d squared. Now we have a particular problem to deal with here. So then it says, find the force that something is exerting on the object when m is 360 over d squared. Let's see, 9 goes into 360, because 9 goes into 36 four times, so this would be 40. So it would be 40 times 40, maybe 1600 to me. Yep. So again, the force exerting on this particular object is 1600. Alright, number one, 3.7. Okay. Okay, 3.7, number one, just kind of quickly going through it here. It says y varies directly with x. Again, y varies directly with x. It should be like this. Let's set up the problem here. We've got to figure out what k is. It says if y is 10 when k is 2. We gotta figure out what k is first. In this case, our proportional constant is 5. So now we write down the problem that's particular to our situation, which is x equal to 5x. Divided both sides by 2. Trying to get k by itself. Not yet. So we figured out the general problem for our problem. Now we say, find y when x is 6. So we figured out the particular relationship. Y is just 5 times as big as x. Now if x is 6, that means y has to be 30. So it's always, first of all, you set up the general problem. Find your particular k value. Set up the specific problem and then solve.
You know what I find is that we don't get enough example problems like that in school for us to go back and follow up. This is question one. I still think we don't have enough. But it was hard to try to figure it out.
So that's why I gave you, there's the example problem in the book, and then our lecture notes is sort of the practice problem. No, I agree. The book does not give you as many example problems as need be. But for this particular one, example number one is just like problem number one. Only difference is k is equal to 3 instead of 5. I can't blame it on this one, but I know in general, yes, there are. There's not enough problems. Okay, moving on. Alright, 3.7, number 24. It's a even problem here. So again, something you don't have the answer to. It says the circumference of a wheel is directly proportional to its diameter. A wheel has a circumference of 8.5 feet and a diameter of 2.7 feet. Cool. Let's go for it here. Let's set it up. Notice it says directly proportional. So C, I'm going to use C as circumference, is directly proportional to its diameter. Again, same type of problem. We got to figure out what the K value is. So it says, if the circumference is 8.5, the diameter is 2.7. Again, making it look a little nicer, put 2.7 in front of k. But anybody, what is 8.5 divided by 2.7? Something like that. 3.148, is that it?
Yeah.
Okay. Just to make it look a little nicer, I'm gonna go 3.14. Again, our numbers will be just slightly off. That's okay. Let's see if it's okay. Ah, you know what they even have? you did it like this, right? The book actually leaves it as a, this is what they do. They multiply this by 10, multiply this by 10, and they have it as 85 over 27. They leave it as a fraction, which is approximately pi. It's approximately 3.14. Okay, find the equation that relates circumference and diameter. So I'm going to give you two answers for this, depending what you want to do. C is equal to 3.14d, or C is equal to 85 over 27d. Either or will be fine. Graph the equation from part A in the first quadrant only. Okay, so we're going to do this here. It's going to be 0, 0 here. Diameter 1. One is going to be 3 and 0.14. So it has to start off at 0, 0, first of all. But can this diameter be bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger forever, forever? Yeah, right. We can think of bigger and bigger diameters. So in this case, we're going to connect these guys like this and put an arrow. 3.14. And again, the way I got that is I plugged in a 1 into here. For D, I plugged in a 0 first. 0 times 3.14 is still 0. 1 plugged into that is still. What is the circumference of a wheel that has a diameter of 3.1 feet? C, what's the circumference of a wheel that has a diameter of 11.3 feet. Well, there it is. Can we just multiply 3.14 times 11.3? Okay, 35 point, I'm going to say 5, is that okay?
Yeah.
And this is in terms of feet. And the correct answer is 35.6 because they use that fraction answer. Either or is fine. From there. Some more problems. Let's see what we got here. 3.8. Finally done. It's been an hour later almost. 21:45. 3.8. 21. All right. And these guys, again, algebra of functions. What do we do with functions here? So this is 3x minus 5. G is x minus 2, and we have a third function. H is the big one. H is 3x squared minus 11x plus u plus 10. For 21, we got to do f divided by h. So again, that is shorthand to write f of h of x. That is shorthand to say that's the abstract function. And that is even shorthand to write this, f of x divided by h of x. And so what we do is we put in the value itself. So this is 3x minus 5. H is 3x squared minus 11x plus 12, plus 10. And the only question we have for us is the question is whether this guy reduces or not. Can I factor the bottom? Just maybe. 3x squared changes into a 3x times x. And a positive 10 to make a negative 11 at the end. Maybe possibly a minus 5 over here. Right? Because if we cancel, it's going to be the same. That means this would have to be a minus 2 there. Let's see if that happens. So multiply these guys. Negative 3x, that's a negative 6x, plus negative 5x makes negative 11x. Perfect. Okay. And then, because that is the case, I can cancel the top, which means 1 on top, x minus 2 on the bottom. There's my value. Alright, a company manufactures and sells DVDs. Here are the equations that use a connection with those businesses. A whole bunch of different stuff here. This is the business one. Remember, revenue, cost function, all that good stuff. So it says, revenue R of X, the production of the number of DVDs sold each day, and the selling price. Oh, find the functions here. So it actually tells you, R of X is numbers that you sell, number sold times your selling price. So that's numbers that you sell. I'll put it like this. Numbers that you sell times price. That's what revenue is. So if you look back at the top equation, your number of DVDs sold each day, that actually is N of X. And that's going to be just X because that's the value of it. The price, that's P of X. I just sort of switch back P of X to the top. Looking down, that gives you 11.5 minus 0.05x. Okay. And I don't know if they want you to multiply everything out or just sort of leave it. Yeah, they want you to multiply it out. So this is R of X. Simplifying everything over, multiply the X in. Write it like that, or you can write it as this. You can move this to the front, so negative 0.05x squared plus 11.5x. Okay, B, the cost function. What does cost include? It says the sum of the fixed costs, so fixed plus variable costs. So look back over here, it says daily fixed costs are 200, daily variable costs are 2x. So plugging that in gives you 200 plus 2x. Also you can write it as 2x plus 200, but there's your cost. So every single day, somehow, for this company, they have to give up 200 bucks. And then depends how many they sell for manufacturer. Okay, P is the profit. Profit is the difference of revenue subtract the costs. So the revenue function is running out of space here, so let me move my equal sign just a little bit here. Let me move this guy over here. R of X is this piece right here, whichever one you want to take. I'm going to take this one here. So this is negative 0.05x squared plus 11.5x. Subtract 2x plus 200. Negative 0.05x squared plus 11.5x minus 2x minus 200. And sorry for the chicken scratch here. This is 11.5 subtract 2. 9.5 subtract 200. Ooh. One of my nephews is going to Fresno State. He's an international business. That's his major. And it was funny. We were talking about all this good stuff here. Is price points. how do you sell something? How do you figure out market value to figure out what would be the most profit? How do you pilot a product to see how much revenue is generated? All this interesting, good stuff, using a whole bunch of statistics to see if it's worth it or not. And so they had to do a couple of projects where they actually had to actually go and talk to other people at Fresno State. Hey, would you buy this? How much would you pay for it? Blah, 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 you know? And so they had to actually test a certain product out in the market to see. And then they have to look at cost functions for this and see if it's even worth to make it or not. So, something similar with some statistics added into it, yeah. So a little bit higher level with stats in it. Okay, final. Average cost. What is the average cost for the number of tapes sold each day? Even though it's not tapes, it's actually DVDs, so it's written incorrectly. Average cost is the quotient of a cost and the number of tapes sold each day.
Why do you have that?
Yeah, this is called C bar or C average. Average cost is the cost to you each time divided by the number of units sold. Okay, cool. No, not cool. Yes, there was no applications whatsoever in the section for 3.8. Not going to be on the online homework.
But when we see that little C within the average cost, that
uh-huh.
should be a fraction.
Uh-huh.
So when we see it like that, that's a fraction.
Uh-huh. Class, just real quick here, let's focus on D just for a little bit. I think this is an interesting application. That's kind of the reason why I chose this problem. Thinking about average cost, if we were to produce one object of these guys, what's our cost for one particular object?
Well,
so let's plug in the one in for the x, right? So 2 times 1 plus 200, $202 divided by 1. It's costing us $202 to produce a candy bar. No one's going to buy this candy bar, I bet you. Okay? Yeah. But now let's do this here. What happens if we produce 100 of these and sell 100 of these per day? 100 times 2, 200 plus 200, 400. 400 divided by 100. Now it's gone to $4. And if it's a very good candy bar, maybe. But do you see the difference though? If you can only produce one and sell one, that average cost is so high. And so we had a little problem about 4 years ago. It's called GMC in Detroit. Their cost to produce a vehicle and sell a vehicle was lower than their costs to pay all employees, pay compensation, pay pension plans, and all that stuff. And they were in complete trouble because they were flipped like this. Because they're paying out too much money. It's interesting. Let me show you this real quick here. This is kind of interesting too. You got this little munchkin right here. Has the same problem. Anybody want to do this sometime? It's called the Sky Car. This guy named Moeller, genius. He has like 12 patents for the U.S. Army and military because he can invent stuff just on top of his head. Like, oh yeah, you know this, and he invents it. So, just real quick here, just out of curiosity, let's see what this guy is. This guy is called a Sky Car, and he has the same problem. His cost to manufacture one of these and sell these is roughly $10 million if he does one.
Oh.
So, is anybody going to buy a flying car for $10 million?
No.
Some people would, but not her. How many? What about if it came down to $10,000? Would someone buy it? A lot more would buy it, right? But check this out. This is kind of cool stuff. The operating ceiling, which is where it flies at, is 36,000 feet. And now this is just you flying in your own individual car to wherever you want to go. Speed, cruising speed is 308 miles an hour. And top speed is 331 miles per hour. Not bad. I can finally get to Kalinga and Fresno and sleep in a lot. They have produced it. They'd use ethanol gas. Burns a little hotter for the engines. You can't get it off the ground because, first of all, there's no infrastructure to manage all these cars. And what they're probably thinking of doing is you go to these little pods in one city, and it's going to be automatic pilot, and they fly you to the other city, and once you get off the next pod, then it turns into manual drive. So you won't be flying it, you'll be sitting back and sleeping. That's the way I would do to work. But $10 million, not going to happen. So we have something called Google Cars. Google Cars is Google. You have this humongous thing on top of the car. No, there's field testing, and according to this, the military has tried. There's, I think, 4 or 5 that he built. So, and the military have flown them, enjoyed them, but not the general public. So we have something called Google Cars. Google Cars, not $10 million. Roughly $30,000. It's this humongous antenna that sits on top of the car and it drives yourself. $30,000. More manageable? Would someone be willing to pay $30,000 to sit back and fall asleep behind the wheel and then wake up whenever they get there?
No.
No.
Say
again? What do you mean signal? Oh, it loses a signal. That would be a problem. But they've been testing them for the last 5 years. They've drove over 3 million miles on them, 2 car accidents, and none of them were their fault. It was the human error of the other driver. And California, Nevada, Florida, and 3 more other states have allowed use of them for piloting purposes. So, again, more manageable than flying, right? And that's the whole thing about average cost. How much does it take to produce something? How much does it take to... Totally. To fall asleep behind the wheel and wake up? Yeah. All right. Let's get back to math.